Yes, I will teach you. Permanently, I will teach you. Okay, so don't worry. Let us now start our work. Don't worry, always for every one person happy, there will be one person who will be unhappy also. So don't worry. Nothing. CDR sir is back. There is a clash in our schedules. Okay, so because of the clash in schedules, I was forced to change. CDR sir is doing the class for the JE students. So don't worry, he is there. He will come. We will after 1 or 2 months. He will come to NEET. I will go to JE. Don't worry. That is small thing. We will solve that problem. Okay. Okay, so I hope you are able to see my screen. I am going to, I don't generally teach, but yeah, I go to KNM, I go to all the schools, but I go to KNMS more. I come to Blossom also. I go to all the schools, don't worry. Yeah, okay, forget about all that. So let us just focus on our work. Now there is a change in syllabus for you guys. There is some syllabus which has been removed. So the next chapter that I am going to do is atomic structure. Okay. So we will read atomic structure. So I hope you guys have your notebooks and we will start reading. Now before I start with atomic structure, I will tell you some basic ground rules. Number one, I will take approximately 9 classes to discuss atomic structure completely. Yeah, 9 classes I'll be discussing atomic structure. Around 2 classes I will be doing numericals. Okay, then after the next week, this week you won't get it. Next week, I will give you 2 assignments. I will give 2 assignments. I would expect you to work it out. Then this week test is redox. Next week, next Sunday's test will be atomic structure. Full atomic structure will be coming there in your exam. Okay, this Sunday's portion, the coming Sunday's portion is redox. After this Sunday's portion, the next Sunday's portion is atomic structure. Before that, there will be 2 assignments which will come to you on Learnity and you will have to submit on Learnity. Okay, so we will go by this. So by next week, I will be able to do good amount of atomic structure I will do. Mostly my theory classes will be around 5 or 6 theory classes. The rest of the time will go mostly in problem solving and discussing your doubts and other things. Yeah. So that is the way we will work. So I am expecting that you are having nice new page. On the new page, you have put a heading called atomic structure and we are working with atomic structure. Okay. Then just give me 1 minute. I got into some unnecessary slides. Yeah, so now in atomic structure, basically the first person to ever give us any idea about what an atom is and tell us more about an atom was a scientist by the name Dalton. Dalton gave us an idea of what an atom is. According to Dalton, an atom is the smallest indivisible particle of matter which can exist and has the properties of the substance of the element. So that is an atom. So an atom is the smallest indivisible particle which has the properties of the element, they do not have independent existence. They do not have independent existence. But can, for short durations of time, they are the building blocks for all matter. So atoms combine together to form molecules. So this is what an atom is. So mankind has always been trying to think, what is the shape of an atom? So different people conducted different experiments. Okay, primarily J.J. Thomson conducted some experiments, and he is one of the first persons to tell, okay, this is how an atom could look. But this is not there in our syllabus, so we won't discuss about it. After J.J. Thomson, J.J. Thomson had a student by the name Rutherford. Rutherford did an experiment called the gold foil experiment. Okay, and based on his gold foil experiment, he gave us a model of the atom. Yeah, this is also removed from your syllabus. But even though this is removed from your syllabus, we will start from here, and then we will start working from here. Okay, now what Rutherford did, Rutherford took a gold foil. He took a gold foil and bombarded it with alpha particles. Okay, so first question, why did he take gold foil? He could have taken any other element. Yes, but gold is the most malleable and ductile material. I won't say most, I'll say highly malleable and ductile material. Because it is highly malleable and ductile material, he could make real thin sheets. So thin that here in this thickness, there may be very few atoms, one or two or three. Ideally, he expected it to be one or two, but there could have been little more than that. Yeah. So he was able to get that thin variety, the thin sheet of gold. A thin sheet is what is called as a foil. Okay, if you remember, if you go and eat kaju katli, if you go to Sri Krishna Sweets and buy kaju katli, on top there will be some silver colored thing. So that is a silver foil. Okay, so the same way they have gold foil. In Trichy, you don't get sweets which have gold foils. But if you go to Rajasthan, you will be able to buy sweets which have some gold foil on that. So it is real thin. So thin that around the thickness, there will be one or two atoms. Okay, so this was gold foil. Gold foil is like a sheet, right? Now, he took alpha particles and he bombarded the alpha particles. Now, when he threw the alpha particles at it, his first observation is that most of the alpha particles, just passed through. Without any disturbance. So it's like this. You have a curtain and the curtain seems to be on, and you had 10 balls in your hand and you threw those 10 balls, all the balls passed through the curtain. So what can you infer from that? I can infer that there was no curtain. Yes, just knowing the concept is enough. Okay, if you study the, no, silver is not poisonous. Silver is very good for health. 1 gram of gold can be drawn into 2 kilometers of wire. Okay, good. Okay, video is lagging. Okay, voice and video are not in sync. Please check. Okay, I will check. Your audio is good, but your video is lagging. Okay. So slide 2. Okay, so yeah, so here is slide 2. Here is slide 2. Atom is the smallest indivisible particle which has the properties of the element. Some of the properties, it cannot have all the properties, especially the chemical properties. They do not have independent existence, but can exist for short durations of time. Now, they are the building blocks of all matter. So that was the definition of an atom given by Dalton, John Dalton. Okay. Beyond that, the next study was made. I'm not writing anything on the board, so don't worry. So beyond that, the next study was made by this scientist called J.J. Thomson. J.J. Thomson in the late 1800s proposed an atom of proposed a structure for an atom. His proposal was a plum pudding model of an atom. That means atom is like payasam with the draksha and the cashew that you put as the electrons. So J.J. Thomson had discovered an electron. So they found out that atoms could be broken into smaller particles, which are called electrons, protons, and neutrons. So they didn't know about protons and neutrons, but they knew about electrons. So in J.J. Thomson's world, an atom is like payasam. The payasam is positively charged. In that positively charged, you have interspersed some draksha. That draksha is negatively charged. Okay, so that is what was J.J. Thomson's model of an atom. We don't need it because it is removed from our syllabus, but you might have learned this in your lower classes. Yeah, so we are going next to Rutherford's model. Rutherford's model is also removed from the syllabus, but we have to learn a few things from it. So we are trying to learn a few things. So Rutherford took a gold foil. A foil is an extremely thin sheet of gold, and he bombarded it with alpha particles. And his first observation is that his first observation is that most of the alpha particles pass through without any disturbance or without any impact, any effect. So what did he conclude? He concluded that most of the space in an atom is empty, and so the alpha particles could just pass through it without any issues. Do you understand this? Yeah, I am not using the slide, so don't worry. Alpha particle is a helium nucleus. Helium nucleus means helium has 2 electrons, 2 protons, 2 neutrons. So you remove the 2 electrons. So if you remove the 2 electrons, you will get an alpha particle. How did he get an alpha particle? He got an alpha particle from radioactive. Radio, R-A-R-A-D-I-O-A-C-T-I-V-E, radioactive material. How did he get this radioactive material? His friend, Marie Curie and Perry Curie, they had gifted them some radioactive radium. They had discovered radium. After they discovered radium, they had given them. Becquerel had also discovered uranium by that time. So once they discovered pitch blende, that is an ore of uranium which releases alpha particles, they took those alpha particles. Okay, so what do I do? Okay, hang on, I'll just log out and log in again. Yeah, sorry, I'll just log out and log in again. Yeah, so now I hope you are able to see the screen. So an alpha particle is a positively charged nucleus. An alpha particle is a positively charged particle. It is the helium nucleus. That is, helium has two protons, two electrons, and two neutrons. So you remove the two electrons from helium. If you remove the two electrons from helium, you will get He2+. So this is an alpha particle. Where do you get it from? So this alpha particle is got from... Okay, 1 minute. Yeah. Okay. I got it. Yeah. Yes. Now you can see the screen. So an alpha particle is a positively charged particle. It is basically the helium nucleus. Okay. Helium basically has two protons, two electrons, and two neutrons. So you remove the two electrons, what you get is a helium nucleus. So that is an alpha particle. Okay. Now, what you have to understand is that these alpha particles were got from radioactive material. Yeah, so if you take uranium, if you take radium, it releases alpha particles. So we don't need to know all that. So all that we need to know is he took a gold foil, and if he took a gold foil and then he bombarded it with alpha particles, the first observation that most of the alpha particles pass through it. Without any deviation, without any impact. So now, because most of them pass through without any impact, he concluded that an atom consists of vast empty spaces. An atom consists of vast empty spaces. The second observation that he had is that a few of the alpha particles, a few of the alpha particles were deviated through large angles, That means some of them came like this and they went away this side. They got deviated through large angles. A few of the alpha particles deviated at large angles. That was the next observation. Yeah. Slide four. Here is slide four. This is slide five. And alpha particles come from radioactive material. Most is an ore of uranium. Marie Curie, Pierre Curie, Becquerel, they were all working on these materials and then they gifted to each other. So the second observation is that a few of the alpha particles were deviated to large angles. The observation is that there must be a positive charged body, inside the atom. A few of the alpha particles were deviated through large angles. So here is the fourth slide. Okay, this is the fourth slide. Here is the fifth slide. Fourth slide I will keep for one more minute. Fifth slide. sixth slide. Most of the alpha particles passed through it without any impact. A few of the alpha particles were deviated to large angles. What is the meaning that he concluded? That there must be a positive charge center, because positive charge, there will be repulsion. Positive charge, there will be repulsion. Because of that, he said that, you know, there must be a positive charge center. Okay. Yeah, pitch blend. Pitch blend is the name of a ore of uranium. No, nothing deviated in small angles. Nothing deviated in small angles. I mean, forget about the book. What I'm telling you is the right thing. Don't worry about it. So this was the first observation. Fourth slide, you want me to reach the last. An alpha particle is a helium nucleus. Helium nucleus. It's a radioactive material. Radioactive material, their friends Marie Curie and Pierre Curie. Then another friend is by the name, another friend, Marie Curie, Becquerel, B-E-C-Q-U-E-R-E-L, Becquerel. Okay, so yeah, so a few of the alpha particles were deviated through large angles. So from there, he concluded that most of the alpha particles, I mean, there must be a positive charged body inside the atom. Okay. Then the third point is that a few of the alpha particles were reflected back. Okay, were reflected back. That means this is the thing, this is the gold foil. They were pushed this way and then they were reflected back. So when they are reflected back, very few of them, one in a million, okay, very few of them. So the positively charged center, the conclusion is that the positively charged body, the positively charged object or is very small. The positively charged object is very, very small. So that was the conclusion. So the first conclusion is that an atom consists of vast empty spaces. The second conclusion was that there is a positively charged object. The third conclusion was that this positively charged object is very, very small. And on some further studies, they found out that this is at the center and is very heavy. This is at the center and very heavy. So based on these observations, he gave a model which is called the planetary model. Planetary model of an atom. So based on this, he came up with a model which is called the planetary model of an atom. Okay, so it is the three observations which are important. First, most of the alpha particles passed in undeviated, meaning there is a lot of empty space. Second, few of them were reflected through some angles. Okay, now if they were reflected through some angle, that means there must be something positive which is reflecting another positive charge. Then very, very few of them returned back. That means this positive charge is very, very, very small. And if the number on both the sides are equal, then you can say that it is present in the center of the atom. So based on this, his model of an atom is that an atom consists of a nucleus with the electrons revolving around it in circular orbits. Now this is what is referred to as the planetary model of an atom. So Rutherford's model is a nucleus is at the center of the atom, and it contains all the mass and positive charge in an atom. And the electrons revolve around the nucleus. Just as the planets revolve around the sun. Okay, the electrons revolve around the as the planets revolve around the sun. So this is the model that he suggested, which is called the planetary model of the atom. He said the nucleus is at the center based on hey, you guys are not listening properly. You guys are just arguing. I have no problem. Yes, tell me, if one in a million are reflected, is this a small number or a big number? If one in a million are reflected, is it a small number or a big number? Yeah, so common sense says that this is a small number. So this is what is the observation. This is what I wrote here, that one in a million are reflected back. And because one in a million are reflected back, he concluded that the positively charged body is very, very small. Okay, so now I don't understand any reason for any objection to this statement. So tell me, what do you object? What is the objection? Then I also told very, very few particles are getting deviated. So here, very, very few particles are getting deviated, I am saying. Okay, deviation. Deviation is what? Here they are coming like this and they are going this way. So this angle here. So this angle here is theta, is large angle. At large angles I have written. I am getting at large angles. At large angles means the theta is a large angle. Large angle means what? Something 180 degree, less than 180, but close to 180. So 179, 160, 170. These are all the large angles. So very few of them here. A few of the alpha particles here. Most of the alpha particles pass through without any deviation. So most pass through without any deviation means they did not get deviated. Atom is empty. Now a few particles were deviated through at large angles. Here, this angle here is large. Okay, and then a few of them reflected back. Now, I don't know what is your problem with this English. I don't understand. So, because one in a million got reflected, wherever it is hitting, that is very, very small. Now, because there is a positive charge here, a positive charge comes this way and then it gets deflected. It gets deflected here. So I don't understand what is the problem for these statements which are clearly made. Yeah, I've been very clear with that. A few of them have got, what is it that you don't understand, Rahul? Tell me what you don't understand. Don't tell me I don't understand. Re Baba, you are throwing, there is a wall, you are throwing stones at it, or you are throwing balls at it. One ball in a million comes back. What can you infer from that? Tell me. There is a wall in front of you. You have 100 balls or million balls with you. You have thrown these million balls at it. One ball has got reflected. So what will you get? What will you conclude from it? I am not asking for my explanation. I am asking you, what will you conclude from it? There is a wall in front of you. I have given you 5 balls. You threw the balls at the wall. None of the balls got reflected. What will you conclude from it? I am asking. Forget about my explanation. No. If there is no hole, the balls will come back. There is no wall. Precisely. Precisely, that is the explanation. Yeah. So now I threw 1 million of them. When I threw 1 million of them at the same time, only 1 or 2 came back. Means there is an obstruction in the wall, which is very, very small. Okay. So that is what I am trying to say. Yeah, I will show you the slide. Some of you are first asking questions, then you want to start thinking. Okay, anyway, no issues. I will repeat again. This is the 5th one. Please try to write down. Please try to think first. Then you ask me. I will answer the same question 200 times. I have no problem. But I'm getting a feeling that without even listening, you guys are asking questions. Yeah, please draw this diagram. Please draw this diagram and try to make some sense. That I am throwing a lot of alpha particles on the gold foil. Now, when I throw a lot of particles at the gold foil, 1 in a million, 1 million is 10^6. Okay, 10 lakhs. So if I throw 10 lakh alpha particles, 1 or 2 alpha particles are coming back. So what can I infer? I can only infer that whatever is forcing it to come back is very, very small. So that is the inference that Rutherford made, that the positively charged object in the atom is very, very small. Okay, so this is slide number 6. This is slide number 7. I will wait for one more minute. Okay, then this is the 8th one. So based on that, this is how he drew his model. That these are the electrons which are revolving around the nucleus in circular orbits. Okay, and most of the atom has empty spaces and there is a small nucleus at the center. Now, if suppose a particle is coming this way, it will go this way. Okay, now if I measure this angle, it's a small angle. If I measure this angle, it's a large angle. Okay. Now I am measuring this angle. It's a large angle. Somebody wants to measure this angle. No problem. Then it becomes a small angle. That is why I drew the graph. I drew the diagram and then I explained. Because angle is a matter of perception. Okay. We can talk about that angle or we can talk about this angle. So most of the alpha particles passed undeviated. A few of the alpha particles got deflected, but they passed through at large angles. So this angle is large. Then some of you may say, okay, we are talking about this angle. So that angle is small. No problem. Either way, it is okay. Okay. Then a few of the alpha particles got reflected back. So this one won't get reflected. It will just go undeviated. Okay. So few of them got reflected back. So this is what is the conclusion that he came up with. Yeah. What is after the positively in the third conclusion? I will tell. Rahul, is it understood now? Baba, I'm explaining. You can say, Kavi Priya, you can say it is small, but what is that angle? That is what I'm trying to say. So I'm saying that we have to be open-minded. Now you see, there is the nucleus here. There is the electron going here. Now a particle is coming this way. It is going this way. Now this angle is small. Okay. Now this I can also measure by this angle. This angle is large. Yeah. So now, okay, no particle came like this and went like this. It won't, it cannot happen. So this case of large angle is not possible. So this angle only can be large. This angle is small. Okay, now few alpha particles which came here, they will hit and then they will come back. So this is reflected. So reflected, deflected. If you're talking about this, you're talking about small angle. If you're talking about this, you're talking about large angle. That's why there has to be a diagram. Okay, nothing wrong with it. If you want to write small angle, we'll write small angle. No issues. Yeah, okay. Okay, so we will write, if you want small angle, we'll write small angle. No problem at all. Why he said, now he further did some more search. See, by the time people knew little bit more physics, when they knew little bit more physics, an atom is neutral. Now it cannot happen that the positive charge is on one side and the electrons are rotating around it like this. Yeah. So because an atom is neutral, and there was, they did some studies. They did some studies and ultimately they came to a conclusion that the nucleus is at the center. Okay. How did they come to a conclusion? Suppose there is an atom like this and I throw 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Now see what will happen is this will pass through, this will go, this will go. So there is symmetry here. So by observing where the particles are hitting, the alpha particles are hitting, I see that there is some symmetry. Because there is symmetry, I am able to say that it is at the center. Forget about it. The book doesn't say how he was able to say that it is at the center, but he said that it is at the center. Okay. In fact, after the second point itself, he said that there is a positively charged nucleus at the center of the atom. Okay. So this is removed from our syllabus. So let's not bother about it. But let us understand that there is a planetary model of an atom. Okay. Now, if there is a planetary model of an atom, what we are most interested in, please write down. I'm not writing anything. I am dictating. So please write down objections to the planetary model. Yes. Any problems? Yes. Rahul, any issues? What are the problems? When it hit in the electron, no, it will not get reflected. An electron is very, very light. So when a heavy ball comes and so electron is like alpha particle is 3000 times heavier than 4000 times heavier than an electron. So when the alpha particle will ask, it will not. We have done with rotation. We have done with redox. We are doing the next one, atomic structure. It will not get reflected if it hits the neutral part. It will get reflected only if it hits hitting a positive part. A neutral part won't. You just imagine there is one ball. You take another ball and you kick at it. The ball won't reflect back. Okay, the ball won't reflect back. Both the balls will be moving in the same direction. In the third conclusion, that there is a positively charged center. 1 minute. This is the second one. Yeah, positively charged. Object is very small. The positively charged object is very small. That is the third conclusion. Okay. If and so let me write down. If an alpha particle hits an electron, both move forward. If an alpha particle hits a neutral particle, it will not move backward. Okay, only if it hits a positively charged particle, it won't actually hit it. There will be repulsion. It will get pushed back. Alpha particles get reflected only when it hits positively charged nucleus. Okay, otherwise there will be no reflection. If it was neutral, it won't get reflected. Yeah, so what are the objections to Rutherford's model? The only objection to Rutherford's model is when an electron rotates in a circle, it radiates energy. So the electrons must be radiating energy. Okay, now if they are radiating energy, their energy must be reducing. So if energy is reducing, the electron must collapse into the nucleus. Okay, so here, when an electron rotates in a circle, it radiates energy. Maxwell is a scientist who found this. Okay, so the electrons must be radiating energy. Now, if they are radiating energy, their energy must reduce. If it is reducing, the nucleus being positive, electrons being negative, it should come together and the electron should collapse into the nucleus. But it was not happening. So this is the objection to Rutherford's model. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Eleventh slide. Law of conservation of energy. If somebody has energy and somebody is releasing energy, then what will happen to the energy? Energy will reduce. So if the energy reduces, the object stops. So if the object stops, the nucleus is going to gobble it up. So it is radiating. Radiating means giving away. So it will have some energy. So now if it is giving away energy, then this energy will keep on reducing. So once it keeps on reducing, a stage will come when it gobble it away. Okay, the electron will stop. Then the proton, then the nucleus will attract it and then pull it towards itself. But this is not happening. Because this is not happening, this model was rejected. Okay. So now, I hope this is understood now. Yeah, I just showed you the 11th slide. Radiating means giving, emitting. Here is the 10th slide. Here is the 11th slide. Here is the 12th slide. Radiating means emitting. Emitting means releasing. Giving out. So its energy must be reducing. Okay. So if you understand this, then what we can do is we can go to the I don't understand. Not possible means what is not possible? Yeah, those are the objections. Okay, so now if this objection is true, there must be something wrong in what is happening, right? So the next model was given by one of Rutherford's student. So in the next class by Niels Bohr. So next class onwards, tomorrow onwards, we will learn about the Bohr's model of an atom. So in your syllabus, we have from Bohr's model of an atom. The Bohr's model of an atom is a continuation of Rutherford's model. That is why we had to first read Rutherford's model. Okay. So tomorrow's class, we will continue with beyond, and then we will. We will move on. Okay. Yeah. Then one second. I don't know. I lost all slides. Oh God. Yes, this is a new chapter. This is a new chapter, Atomic Structure. Bohr is a student of Rutherford. No questions from this model will come in your exam. Okay, so only what we read from next chapter, we will get it. Yeah, this first chapter also, a lot of it has been removed. So don't worry about it. Rutherford is a student of J.J. Thomson. Yes. I lost all the slides. So I'm not able to get them. I'm sorry about it. You will get the recording. So don't worry about it. Yeah, so I lost all the slides. Okay. Yes, you should write Rutherford's model in your classwork. Don't worry, we will come as and when each chapter, I'll tell you what is removed. So in the atomic structure, only from Bohr's theory is there in your syllabus. Okay, before Bohr's theory, nothing is there. Yeah, you take a break and then come back. Bye.